First of all, thank you very much for having me here. I'm a plastic surgeon practicing in Dubai. I'm going to talk about structured analysis in nose to achieve a natural result in rhinoplasty. And subject I've chosen because rhinoplasty is a very common procedure done here, particularly in the Middle Eastern and the Asian patients. A lot of time we see a lot of unnatural results and anesthetic results. So we like to analyze those. Now, what the aim of presentation is to have a detailed analysis of a patient for rhinoplasty and create a system to analyze the problems. Second is I would like to emphasize on patient education so that they are aware of what are possible and what are not possible. Then creating a surgical plan precisely preoperatively. And finally, I'd like to analyze some causes of complications and unsatisfactory results. Now, we follow a systematic protocol for all patients who come for rhinoplasty, including the patient medical history, detailed information on the procedure so they understand it very well, and always including a PowerPoint slide presentation to show them limitations of surgery and what can be done and what cannot be done. Then obviously a preoperative worksheet. Now this worksheet is very important for us because here we identify problems, whether the patient wanted corrected or not corrected, and also to tell them what is possible and what is not possible. And obviously the rest of the things like preoperative photographs, informed consent and post-op protocol. Now this is a typical booklet that all the patients of rhinoplasty carry with them, and that has all the information that they require. Now, but the most important thing is the analysis of the patient, and this is what helps us to give them a good natural result. And a typical analysis begins with obviously a nasofacial analysis in the frontal position, understanding the skin type and facial proportion, because we see a different community of patients coming with different needs and desires. The sequence of assessment is then the bony vault and the middle vault and the dorsal aesthetic lines. Then we will move to the tip area. We see the alar rims, alar base, and then finally look at the relations of the lip and the chin. And I'll go through again in the detail of what problem we see in this particular patient. Then in the lateral view, we like to see the nasofrontal angle, the nasal length of the patient. Then we see the dorsum and the supratip area. Then we'll look at the tip projection and tip rotation. Alar area to see the alar columellar relationship. And finally, the maxillary and mandibular deficiency and lip chin relationship. In the basal view, we see the dome of the patient. We see the alar shape, whether it's convex or concave. We see the nostril. We see the columella and the alar base. And not forgetting the nasal airway evaluation, where we look at the important structures, turbinate, septum, but most importantly, the internal nasal valves and the external nasal valves. Now, after we have done the analysis, we will put them into a chart where we see all the anatomical problems that the patient has. We see whether it is concerning the patient or not concerning the patient. And based on that, we propose a plan and also the challenges and the complications or what is possible and what is not possible. Now, if you see in this particular patient, of course, the problem is more in the mid-vault area where there is some broadening, and this is what we can correct. Then the problem is in the nasal tip area. Nasal tip area, which is typical bulbous, the alar rim, which is very chubby, the alar base, which is slightly wide. In the profile, again, we assess the patient according to the assessment pattern that we have seen, and we identify that she has most of the supratip problem with fullness in the supratip and with tip deficient tip projection. Then we look at the ala. There is no particular aesthetic definition of the ala. It's wide and chubby. But again, what we cannot do is we cannot thin the ala. Then looking at the alar and columellar relationship, in the basal view, what we see is a wide dorsum, a wide dome. What we see is a convex alar rim here and some alar widening. And then we examine the intranasal in this particular patient, nothing much to be commented. And then this is charted in a worksheet which is prepared preoperatively. Many of these patients go through a lateral cephalometry, which gives us an analysis on the bone and the soft tissue to understand how much of bone reduction they would need. Rarely we do, or sometimes we do X-rays and CT scan if there are any functional problems, or particularly patients with secondary deformities or rhinoplasty. And we use a lot of training and teaching material to the patient to explain to them what can be done, what cannot be done, what are the consequences of altering a lot of nasal structure. Computer morphing, this is a lot of time being demanded by the patients. Preferably we don't do it, but in selective situations it can help to educate the patient, like nasal hump or a dome problem or a lar base problem. But we use several other materials to help them understand and help us understand what patient is looking for. Now this particular patient, for example, who came for tip plasty, we did a little computer morphing and showed her that just tip plasty may not give her the result and she may need an LR reduction as well. Or for this matter, in this patient who had a hump, wanted a hump reduction, we want to understand how much of hump reduction she is expecting. She wants a straight nose or she wants a ski slope nose. And this gives us an idea on how much or what to give to the patient. And then finally, the principles of the surgery. Now, adequate infiltration, we do a lot of tumescent infiltration to have an avascular field. A good exposure, like our colleague said, adequate exposure by open tip rhinoplasty. Preservation and restoration of normal anatomy at the end of the surgery is the key. Incremental and precise correction of the deformities ensures that we do not overcorrect the problem, and specific attention to the nasal airway. Then the operative approach is planned. Most of the time we prefer open approach. Closed approach has very limited indications. We move on to the primary tip, we assess the tip and accordingly change, move on to the dorsum, understand the cartilaginous component and the bony component. Many of the time we do with our ENT colleague, where they do a lot of work in septum or turbinates. If we don't have an ENT surgeon or we don't need that, we do septoplasties, particularly for graft harvesting, and osteotomy. So this is the pattern of surgery that we follow. And finally, redefining the tip to ensure that it matches the rest of the nasal structure. So there are different variety of suturing pattern of the alar cartilage that can actually reshape the nose. So you don't have to remove a lot of structure from the nose, because removing a lot of things can make the nose look unnatural. Now looking at this particular patient, what did we do for this patient? If you see, there's a lot of soft tissue problem, thick skin, so we conservatively excise the SMAS, which is the fatty area, and particularly in certain areas which will enhance the aesthetics of the nose. Then a little bit of trimming of the lower alar cartilage. Upper alar cartilage, we do not normally excise the upper alar cartilage, but usually the dorsum of the cartilage, which is wide, can give the wide appearance, so we remove partly. And if you're doing that, we use a spreader graft to ensure that the function is restored, and some fat trimming. Now for the dorsum, it's a component reduction we do, cartilage resection, some rasping of the bone, osteotomy. For the tip, there are a lot of sutures, like I said. One is the lateral crural sutures, which can reduce the convexity of the dome. Then the interdomal sutures that will improve or define the tip of the nose. Then supporting sutures to hold on to the septum so that the columella is strong enough. Or we can use a columella graft if required. And some tip grafts to enhance the tip. In this particular patient, she also had a chin implant which was displaced, so that was relocated and repositioned. So that was the final outcome. But during the post-operative study, we still saw that the skin could not adapt to the structure that we created underneath. So what we did was, to focus on the supratip area, we injected some triamcinolone injection for about 2 or 3 times over a period of a few months. And we finally managed to have a good skin redraping on the nose. So the key was to do most of the structural changes internally without many external alterations. Now another patient, when we have a lot of soft tissue here, removing a lot of excess soft tissue and damaging the subdermal fat in this area can cause a lot of deformities externally. So it needs to be precisely removed in certain areas just to enhance the aesthetics. A combination of soft tissue removal, combination of limited cartilage resection, and addition of structures like cartilage graft or even silicone implants or porex implants can enhance the nose without taking away the natural aesthetics of the nose. This is yet another problem: very chubby nose, very thick nose, broad nose, thick upper lateral cartilages, thick lower lateral cartilages, without any aesthetic in the ala. So the steps are limited osteotomies, limited resections of soft tissue, limited resections of the cartilage, and building up the tip to enhance the profile of the tip. And minimal intranasal reduction of the ala will ensure that it looks more aesthetic. Now, when we have a problem of a large hump, the question is how much of the hump to be removed. And this is very important to discuss with the patient preoperatively, whether she's expecting a ski slope, which is very rare in our community, or she wants to retain a little hump, which is very common in the Middle Eastern population, or she wants a straight bridge of the nose. And many times we do this computer graphic to understand what patient is expecting, a ski slope or a remnant of residual hump they would prefer, or just a straight nose. And based on that, then the operative plan is made. And this particular patient had an endonasal or closed rhinoplasty for hump reduction. Now, when we do hump reduction, if they want a straight arch, we make sure that we reconstruct the dorsum at the end by the residual hump. When we do the hump reduction, we ensure that the components are separated to ensure that we do not destroy the mucosa in this area. We make sure that the upper lateral cartilage is separated out, and then we resect the septum. If it is required, we can add a spreader graft in this area to maintain the function of the internal sphincter. Now, this is an example then postoperatively. Sometimes you have patients with deformities, severe deformities. Again, an assessment important, and it's important to assure that the patient understands what is asymmetry and what are the areas that are deviated and deformed, and what is the limitation, whether it is possible to make the nose completely straight or there could still be some residual deviation left behind, which is often the case in severe deformities. So the procedure was open tip rhinoplasty in this, dorsum was exposed, hump was reduced, bony and cartilaginous. Septoplasty was done through the dorsal approach itself, medial and lateral osteotomies, spreader grafts was used to restore the function, and tip reconstruction was done using the various suture techniques. And that was the outcome of the patient, and it remained well postoperatively for long term. Just a little word about refinement rhinoplasty. Now, refinement rhinoplasty is a new terminology for patients who have normal nose and they're still desiring some improvement in the nose. And it's very challenging to make sure that these nose do not then look abnormal after the surgery. Or patients who have very focal problems, like a small hump or a small cartilage bump, or so-called celebrity rhinoplasty who want just to have more dramatic improvement in the nose. Now, this is an example of a nose which is normal. It is not much, it's pretty balanced to the face, but still wanted enhancement. So selectively choosing certain areas just to enhance the aesthetic, doing a little bit of dorsal rasping, doing some osteotomies, doing some tip plasty sutures, does give an aesthetic and a normal result. Yet another patient, pretty normal nose, a little bit of patient considers as a manly nose with a little hump and a projecting tip. Again, a selective reduction could make sure that it is very well balanced. A little bit about elements of unsatisfactory result. Now, these has been classified as soft tissue skin problems, nasal tip problems, cartilaginous, bony, and sphincter problems. Now, let's see some of these examples. And the commonest problem is when you do excessive thinning, and if you damage the dermis of the skin, then you often result with external asymmetry or external deformity or external scars. This is an example of a patient who has excessive thinning, over excision of the cartilage and the fat in this area. And to add to that, she had external splint used for a long period of time that caused skin necrosis. Then the second problem is in the alar area. There's a lot of people who try to excise or reduce the alar, and they go out of the normal aesthetic boundary of the alar, causing scarring or over reduction of the ala, or removal of the cartilage causing pinched ala. And that one example of nose with asymmetrical nostril, ill-defined tip, double barrel gun because of over-resection of the cartilage, and external scarring as you can see in these patients. So the key in these patients is to just remove soft tissue from certain areas and try and enhance the tip and the dorsum and prevent external scars to reduce these excess tissue. Cartilaginous framework, again, the commonest problem we see is deformities due to excess removal of the lower lateral cartilage or sometimes even upper lateral cartilage that causes a lot of functional and aesthetic problem like in this gentleman here. So what has happened in this patient is the lateral crust of the lower cartilage was removed excessively to thin the lip and he had a collapsed nostril on inhalation. Cartilaginous, osteocartilaginous, common problem is either residual hump or most often over excision causing saddle nose or even inverted V deformity. And this is one such example where there is over resection of the dorsum causing saddle nose deformity with excessive tip rotation. Functional problems, again, over resection of the upper lateral cartilage and the lower lateral cartilage can cause literally functionless nose. So this patient became a mouth breather because of this, and she had to have an internal sphincter reconstruction to improve the airway. So the conclusion is factors causing unsatisfactory results. Of course, the patient demand is a big issue. Unrealistic expectations is the problem, and surgeon succumbing to such pressure is a problem. Aesthetic function judgment is important to make sure that we do not make such mistakes. Overdoing is a problem. Underdoing can always be improved, but overdoing has very limited approach afterwards. Understanding the local nasal conditions, important. Patient compliance is very, very important to have a regular follow-up and prevent problems. And that's it. Thank you very much. This is just an opportunity I'd like to take that I've published a book which is purely for charity purpose, and this is to treat children with facial deformities. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parasha, for the brilliant presentation. Would you like to take comments, questions from the audience?
Excellent presentation. Very nice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.